Thank you. And then I want us to look at the cross from another point of view. I want us to look at the sayings of Christ from the cross. We usually hear a sermon like this on Good Friday, and that's about it. But most of us don't go to church on Good Friday, so we never hear it. There are 28 prophecies in the Old Testament about the cross, whole chapters. There's Genesis 22 and Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53 and Leviticus 16 that especially deal with the suffering of Christ on the cross, hundreds and thousands of years before he ever went to the cross. They were under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the writers of the Old Testament. And the first one comes from Psalm 22. Jesus was quoting scripture when he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That's a quote from Psalm 22. But then you go on a little bit further and you'll see why he said it. Because the scripture says, thou art holy. You'll never understand the Old Testament with all of its blood sacrifices. You'll never understand the Bible. You'll never understand the death of Christ on the cross till you understand that God is a holy and righteous and pure God, and he cannot even look upon evil. So in that terrible moment of the agony of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross, he was lonely, forsaken by his friends. And then a shadow comes for the first time since eternity began between God the Father and God the Son, because God cannot look upon sin, because in that moment he was laying your sins and mine on Christ, and Christ was suffering for us. And in that mysterious moment, he was made to be sin for us who knew no sin. Do you know what that means? Made to be sin. Had never known sin, never told a lie, never had an evil thought, never had any greed or lust. All of a sudden, all of that filth and dirt from your life and my life descended on him. And none of us will ever understand the mystery of that moment. No theologian can explain it, to my satisfaction at least. It was God's great love for you that allowed his son to take that suffering. And then the second thing from the cross that we hear is when he said, I thirst. And that's a fulfillment of Psalm 69:21. And when he said, I thirst, they gave him vinegar and drink mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink it. He tasted, as we read later in John, in another one of the Gospels, but he didn't drink it. Why? Because it would have been a sedative. It would have taken away some of the suffering. And he was there to take all the suffering in absolute consciousness for you and for me. He wouldn't take it. He must suffer the terrible agony and carry our sins on the cross in full consciousness for you. And if you had been the only person in the whole world, he would have died for you. And then in Luke 23:34 is another thing that he said from the cross. He said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do. Now, he was talking about those soldiers that were nailing him, the crowd out there that was yelling and screaming at him. 72,000 angels pulled their swords ready to come and rescue him. And he said, no, I'm doing it because I love them. You see, you and I had sinned against God. We'd broken his laws. And he said, in the day that you break my law, you will suffer and die. He said that to Adam and Eve. They broke his law. They sinned. That's what sin is. And you see, God never meant that anybody would ever die. And God did not create hell for us. But we deliberately rebelled against God. And God would not be God. He wouldn't be just and righteous and holy if he came along and patted us on the back and said, you're forgiven. We had to die for our own sins, or somebody who was qualified had to die for us, and that person that was qualified was Jesus Christ, and he volunteered to do it. He died in our place. I heard about a woman writing to a columnist and said that her cure for guilt was to go to the back garden, dig a hole in the earth, lie down on her stomach, speak all of her guilt and confess all of her wrongs into that place that she had dug and then covered up. And people will do almost anything to get rid of their guilt. The place to get rid of guilt is at the cross. For centuries, people have done desperate things to bury their guilt. James Nelson, that we have read about last year, as a boy, in an alcohol-soaked scene, beat his mother to death with a brick. He served 9 years in prison, and during that time, he met Christ at the cross, and the deep repentance and confession of Christ as his Savior and his Lord. He began to study the Bible. He began to be a lay preacher. And last year, he was ordained in the Church of Scotland as a Presbyterian minister. The forgiveness of God, the love of God, the power of the cross to change and forgive. How wonderful and thrilling. And then another thing that he did at the cross that is one of the most touching things to me in all the world. Now there stood by the cross his mother. And he looked to John, one of his disciples, and he said, John, behold this woman. And she said, and he said to Mary, his mother, he called her woman, just like he did at Cana of Galilee, he called her twice woman. He said, woman, behold thy son. And from that hour on, John, his friend and his disciple, took care of his mother. There's a rock group in England called The Cure. Jesus Christ on the cross was the cure for all our human severed and ailing relationships. All the social problems, the oppressed peoples of the world feel the impact of his death on the cross. And then there was another statement from the cross. He said, it is finished. It is finished. What did he mean? In John 17, he had said, I finished the work that thou hast given me to do. God gave him a job to do, and the job was to die on the cross. To this end was I born, he said. He came to die. He's the only man ever born to die. That was why he came. We wonder why he didn't feed everybody and heal everybody. He could have done it. That would have healed some bodies and fed some people that were hungry, and he did that out of compassion. But his real work was the cross. And that's why the cross is so important, because there you're dealing with eternity. You see, the body is going to go to the grave, but your soul, your spirit, that part of you that lives forever, that lives inside of your body, is going to live on and on and on and on. Where is it going to spend eternity, heaven or hell? It'll be decided by the cross, what you do about the cross. Because from the cross, he's asking you to repent of sin and receive him as Lord and Savior. Yes, it is finished. And then he said something else in Luke 23. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Now, I've seen a few people die, quite a number of people die. I've heard the death rattle in their throat, but there was no death rattle in the throat of Jesus. They did not take his life from him. He laid it down voluntarily, and he said in a loud voice, notice a loud voice, he said, I commend my spirit. Into thy hands, O Lord, I commend my spirit. He gave up his spirit to God the Father. And in saying this, he conferred upon every one of us the possibility of the gift of eternal life. You can have eternal life tonight. We were lost, confused, without purpose and meaning in life, no assurance of a future life. And Jesus from the cross reached out by death and rescued us. And we say to him today, Lord and Savior. Are you sure he's your Lord and your Savior? Thousands of people go to church, but they're not sure that they've committed their lives to Christ. And then lastly, there was the statement that he made to a thief on the cross. The crowds down below were shouting, if you're the Son of God, come down and save yourself. Others were saying, he saved others, himself he cannot save. They were mocking, they were jeering, they were laughing. Both of the thieves were criticizing. You see, he was on the cross for 6 hours, and the first 3 hours, they were both criticizing him and making fun of him like the crowds down below. But one of the thieves began to look. They were both guilty. They both deserved to die according to Roman law. But one of them began to look at Jesus, and he began to see something he'd never seen anywhere else before. He saw that Jesus was different, and he began to say to himself, he must be the Son of God. He must be Lord. And he rebuked the other thieves, saying, don't you fear God? We deserve what we're getting, but he hasn't done anything wrong. Then he turned to Jesus and he said, Lord, and that word Lord means my very own Lord. He said, Lord, remember me when you come to your kingdom. What an act of faith. And Jesus said, what did Jesus say? Today, you will be with me in paradise. And the angels of heaven were watching to see who would be the first one that he would take to paradise. It was a thief that deserved hell. The forgiveness and the mercy of God is so far beyond our comprehension that we can hardly talk about it. Yes, that thief is going to be in heaven, and you're going to see him. Jesus took him by the death of the cross. Two thieves. Which are you? Which cross are you on? The one that's rejecting or neglecting or even making fun? Or are you the one that it receives and accepts? I'm asking you to make your commitment to Christ tonight just as simply. What do you have to do? Three things. First, you must repent of your sin. That word repent means to change. Change your way of living. Change your attitude. Now, you cannot do it alone, but God will help you if you're willing. The second thing is by faith receive Christ into your heart. By faith, you cannot come intellectually alone. Man cannot come to God just with his mind. He has to come by faith like a little child trusting his father or mother. And then thirdly, you must be willing to follow him and serve him. It's not just receiving him, it's being a follower of his every hour of the day. You won't become perfect, but you'll change directions in your life. You're going this way, and you're turned by the Spirit of God, and you start a different way. And I'm going to ask you to do something we've seen hundreds of people do here every night. I'm going to ask you to get up out of your seat and come and stand in front of this platform and say, by coming, I want to know when I leave here tonight. The Bible says, he that hardeneth his heart, being often reproved, shall suddenly be cut off, and that without remedy. You may never have a moment like this when you're so close to the kingdom of God again. Come tonight. You may be a member of the best church in town. You may be a counselor. You may be a choir member. You may be a clergyman. But you're not sure how you stand before God. And you want to come to the cross and find forgiveness of all your sins and a certainty that if you died tonight, you'd go to heaven.